On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge in a pear tree.
On the second day of Christmas, my true love gave to me two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the third day of Christmas, my true love gave to me
three French hens,
two turtle doves
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the fourth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the fifth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me
five golden rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves
and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the sixth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me six geese a laying,
five golden rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the seventh day of Christmas, my true love gave to me seven swans a-swimming,
six geese a-laying,
five golden rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens, two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the eighth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me eight maids a-milking, seven swans a-swimming, six geese a-laying,
five golden rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens, two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the ninth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me nine drummers drumming,
eight maids a milking,
seven swans
a swimming,
six geese a laying,
five golden rings,
four calling birds,
three French hens,
two turtle doves and a partridge in a pear tree.
On the tenth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me
pipers piping,
nine drummers drumming,
eight maids a-milking,
seven swans a-swimming,
six geese a-laying,
five
Yeah. So, welcome to the Couples Academy Show. I get into that song. I love that song. I tell you, it's been a while since I heard it, and every time I hear it, I just start flowing. But that was a private moment. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Couples Academy Show. My name is Hassani, and I am in the saddle alone this morning, but I'm not here alone because I've got you. And so every single morning, we come to you with inspiration. We come to you with information to help take your relationship to the next level. Hope you had an amazing weekend. I know that we did. We were doing some Christmas things, some shopping, going out there looking for some ice skating. The people are out. The people are having a great time. Depending upon where you are in the country, I know it may be packed in certain areas and desolate in others. Every state is different. Georgia, you would never think that there was a pandemic in the first place because everybody is out. Yet and still, we are just now 11 days away from Christmas, and we have to remember that even though we're going to be exchanging gifts and eating good food, we can't forget the reason for the season, and it is Christ. It was the day that he was born, the day that we celebrate his birth, and so we want to make sure that you're honoring him in all that you do. Well, listen, guys, this weekend we had our last chance weekend, and it was fantabulous. We had couples from different parts of the country who came in, and it was such a unique experience to be able to do it in a small group setting, where not only did they kind of get some information from Danielle and myself, but they were able to pour into each other and glean from one another and be a support system and an encouragement. And so we were so pleased with what the couples were experiencing. We said, you know what, we need to set up another one and go at it again. So information will be coming shortly about the one that we will have in January. There is a waiting list. People are ready to sign up. And so that information will be coming out shortly. But today we have a topic for you. We're going to be talking about the six mistakes to avoid after the affair is discovered. What do you do? How do you transition? How do you have the right type of conversations to bring about your healing? That's what we're talking about today on the Couples Academy Show. To put my glasses on so that I can welcome all of the listeners and the viewers. So good morning to Angel, to Kathy, to LaShawn, to Michael, to Young God, Loretta, Ronald, a few other names. We love you. trying to pronounce him, Robin B, J. Good to see you guys. Let's get into a great discussion today, because we know that oftentimes when you're discussing an affair, it can be a very, very, very challenging conversation, and you have to know how to quickly navigate through it in order for it to be successful and not triggering, making things incredibly worse. So what does it look like? You've just discovered that an affair has occurred, and sometimes we have a knee-jerk reaction to do what? To make major big decisions. And so we would say quickly making big decisions is a no-no. It is a mistake, because some of us ultimately say, you know what? You did it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to find somebody that I can be with. And so it's what we call revenge affairs and revenge sex, thinking that somehow if we do to them what they've done to us, it will make us feel better. And it will absolutely not. It just creates more of a complication over the course of time. So please push pause, calm down, let us reason together to figure out how we can restore this particular relationship. So trying to have an affair or settling for an open marriage, or you gonna do you, I'm gonna do me, it just makes matters worse. Because even in that space, there comes a point where you come to your senses, the both of you, and you're realizing, you know what, we have kids, we have history, we have all these things that have brought us together, let's work on the relationship. And it just added another level of complexity to restoring the relationship. Another thing that we do as a knee-jerk reaction is telling our spouse to leave, to get out. I'm done. It's over. I'm filing for divorce. And we know that whenever you're making any type of decision, when you are drenched, soaked, and saturated in emotions, it is a decision that you will regret. So if you make an immediate decision to stay, truth be told, you may regret it. If you make a decision to leave instantly, truth be told, you may regret it. Because in that season, in that space, you're highly emotionalized, and feelings are a major part of how you function, how you process, how you think. And so you want to have a balance between your head and your heart to make sure that you're making a sound decision. And sometimes you have to be still. Sometimes you have to allow things to settle. Sometimes you have to allow the right individuals to speak into your ear that will give you wisdom and guidance about how to move forward in that space before deciding to end the marriage. Some people immediately go to a divorce attorney. And you know, if that's one of the individuals that you're listening to immediately, that may be counterproductive as well. And so you wanna make sure that you're surrounding yourself in the right community, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But some people, you know, once the affair is found out, the first thing they're doing is they're going to the locksmith, and they're changing every lock on every door, which is an indication that says, get out, don't come back, I don't want to have anything to do with you. And those type of methods, they're counterproductive, and they ultimately don't work. And you're not really considering all the consequences that are associated with that. And then, you know, we've even seen where people say, you know what, I'm sending the kids to my parents' house. I've got to get away from you. I've got to get away from them. I've got to be in my own space. I don't know what my plan is. And it causes confusion amongst the children, amongst the family. People are alarmed. They're worried. They're concerned. And so those type of methods do not work. They're not healthy, and they don't get you any further to a decision. Now, the second mistake that people make when it comes to having discussions about the affair is telling others. Let me tell you something. We've seen this happen time and time again, where people have had these knee-jerk reactions to just pick up the phone, go on social media, send blast messages out, and to let the world know what their spouse did. So in essence, okay, you want to wreck and ruin my life, I'm going to wreck and ruin yours. Your reputation will be over, your career will be done, your service to the community, to ministry, all of that is hanging in the balance, and because I'm going to expose it. And so we've seen how that has gone horrifically wrong for all parties involved. It's very messy. It just does not serve. And so I don't believe necessarily that you should keep the secret of the affair for the purpose of protecting your partner and no one knowing, because everybody needs somebody. There needs to be somebody that you can have a conversation with. There needs to be somebody who you can share your concerns, your hurts, and your pains with, and they can also speak into your life. This is what we will call a tight, closed community. You know, oftentimes we talk about the importance of talking to the right ones. You don't want to share your problems with people who share your problems. So we talk about the hub and spoke support model. Think about a wheel on a car. You have the hub in the wheel and then the spokes that come out from that wheel. Well, if you place yourself in that circle, in that hub, your spokes of support are the ones who you speak to, and they speak into your life about your situation. And we're talking about an inner core group, right? We're talking about a close friend who has wisdom to impart, possibly a spiritual leader, maybe a non-biased family member who we can go for comfort and for advice. It's all about communicating with the right individuals, because if you communicate with the wrong ones, they will further fuel you to make a decision that is counterproductive. And here's the reality. You want to give yourself some time, right? Because at some point it's going to come out, and you want to make sure that you have the proper messaging for the children based upon their age and what's appropriate. The proper messaging for, you know, family members if it should come out. The proper messaging for those within your community. Rather than doing it in an emotional space, you want to be able to be sound and wise in your approach. And it's not for the sake of exposing, but of seeking support in a community that can aid you all in the process. All right, we got some questions here. I'm going to have to put these glasses on to make sure that I can read them. So, Mona Lisa, so how do you remain still? He still wants to be intimate, but I feel we have not discussed or resolved it. How can you continue to do this day by day? Well, in that particular case, I'm not talking about somebody who's still in the relationship. I'm not talking about somebody who's still connected to an affair partner. We're talking about it's been exposed, it's come out, and you're in the process of reconciliation. If that partner is still involved in the affair, let me recommend a great book for you. There's a book by James Dobson, and it's entitled Love Must Be Tough. And we're probably going to spend some time unpacking it, but it talks about what do you do when you're in a relationship with somebody who refuses to disconnect from that affair partner. And in the book, it talks about how sometimes there's this knee-jerk reaction to try to convince the partner to leave and come on, let's restore the relationship and let's work it out. And in that season, they're not in the right head space or heart space to do so. So in the meantime, what you want to do is you have to have tough love. You have to put certain boundaries in place to protect you, because think about it. If they're in an active affair and you're continuing to engage in them in terms of sex, in terms of normal interactions, the way it was without an affair, then you're putting yourself potentially at risk. So you've got, if he's not willing to protect you, you've got to do things to protect yourself. Hope that makes sense. What if everyone knew but you? Everyone around hid the truth. Well, that's a problem as well. And that's a different situation. That means that there are a number of different reasons why they may not have told you. So I don't want to give a blanket answer. I think some of these statements or some of these questions require a little bit more questioning. But I do believe that there should be someone that should come to you and let you know, listen, this is what's going on. I just want to make you aware. See, for me, you have to understand there's so many people. When you ask the average person, if you knew that your girlfriend or one of your boys or a family member was being cheated on by somebody and you had the proof and you had the facts, would you tell? You would be surprised how many individuals would say, nope, I'm staying out of it. Because if I tell, then they're going to be mad at me because now I told them what they didn't know. And now they're looking at me sideways. And I'm not trying to get in the midst of all that. I'm trying to avoid the conflict. And I don't want to lose a relationship because I was forthright and shared what I knew. You know how many times I've heard that? Now, for me, if I knew, I would be willing to risk a relationship. You know, for me, because I think that that type of truth must come out. And obviously, it speaks to a larger issue. And I'm not telling for the purpose of ending the relationship. I'm telling for the purpose of reconciling. But how do you tell? How do you tell? There's an appropriate method to telling. Like the person who you know who's involved, if you have a relationship with them, it is your responsibility to go to that person and say, listen, I know what you're doing. You need to stop this now. Okay? And you need to tell your spouse. And guess what? If you don't tell your spouse, you're giving me no option but to do it. Matter of fact, I had a pastor that I knew that did the very same thing with his congregation. There was a member of the church who was in an affair, and as a result of that, he did not, the member did not tell the spouse, and the pastor said, listen, you've got X amount of time to end this relationship and tell your spouse, because if you don't, I will. He continued in the affair, and he left the pastor with no choice to do it. So this proper protocol and procedure for getting these type of things done in order to make sure that the truth comes out and reconciliation can take place. These are the things that you've got to be mindful of. Full of. And so, listen, at the end of the day, when the truth comes out, it's how it comes out as well. Because if it comes out the right way, see, the thing is, if it comes out from the spouse, there's a higher possibility and probability that you can get through it. But when it comes out from other means, other people, the affair partner, you found out about it on social media, that can be more damaging in the affair recovery process. That's the challenge with this. And this is why it's so critically important that the communication and the conversation goes tremendously well. All right, we got a lot of comments here. That's a major reason why my spouse's family and I will never be cool. I can understand that because it feels like you've been betrayed, not only by your partner, but by the family who was aware, possibly complicit. And this is why healing is so important. And I understand that that's how you feel now, but I think there's always two different sides to a story, and having those conversations and understanding the perspective that others are coming from, or understanding some of the details associated with it. Some may be not revealing that truth because they don't want to get involved, but they're encouraging your spouse to tell, and they're not willing to cross certain boundaries. So everybody has a different value system and different perspectives on that. What I would not want you to do is to take out on the family something that's deserving of your spouse, because at the end of the day, it was your spouse who violated the relationship, not the family necessarily, but every situation is different. Oh, you got a lot of comments. I know where the loyalty lies. Can't do holidays with those I know will deceive me. I mean, I get that. And when you're in this season of pain, I mean, sometimes it's just good to stay away, because going into certain environments where certain things, you're aware of certain things that have happened, it can cause more harm than good. So there's a season of rest. There's a season of separation, if you will. There's a season of recovery. And right now, that needs to be the season that you're in. It seems like there's a lot of hurt and there's a lot of pain. There's a lot of anger that you're experiencing, not only with the spouse, but with the spouse's family. And so to disengage in this season probably is the best thing for you, for your spouse, for the family. Because in these situations, particularly during the holidays, when people get together, things are said, comments are made, and before you know it, you're scrapping. And that's the last thing that we want. So now I appreciate that question. All right, so let's go to the next one. I was reading these comments. I'm working this board alone, guys, so I need you to stay with me and be patient. All right, so the next thing, number three, the third mistake is attacking the affair partner. And when we say attacking the affair partner, we mean physically attacking the affair partner, verbally attacking the affair partner, exposing the affair partner before the entire world. And the reality is, yes, that affair partner was involved with your spouse, but we don't know that story, okay? Understand, there's a few different stories going on. There's the marriage story that you have with your spouse. Then there's the affair story that your spouse has with that affair partner. Then there's your individual story and your spouse's individual story. We've known that there have been situations, this is not always the case, but there are situations when the affair partner was just as deceived as you were. They had no clue. This caught them by surprise. And so they're like, you're married and you have a family on the other side of town, because some people have been so careful and so meticulous with their lifestyle that that wasn't revealed. And then you have others that are very complicit and know exactly what that person's situation is. But whether they knew or did not know, the reality is that frustration should not be given to the affair partner. It should be given to the spouse, because that's the one that you're in a covenant relationship with. That's the one that you've given vows to. That's the one who has the commitment with you, not that affair partner. Now, I'm not saying that she should go off or he should go off unpunished, but that's not your role to play. Whatever that person needs to do for their own healing, their own reconciliation, that's what they need to do. But what we're focusing on is what needs to happen in your household with your partner. That has to be the focus. So keeping the main thing, because when you, and I've seen this, you've seen this in television shows, you've seen this in movies where, you know, I found out that my man or my woman had an affair, and so the spouse is attacking the affair and they're fighting in the street, and it's just like the spouse is sitting there watching it all happen. And really, I've always said, I said, your energy is going toward the wrong one. It needs to be towards, not that we're condoning physical violence, not at all, but in terms of your frustration and where things should be dealt with, it should be dealt with inside the home. So hopefully that makes sense. All right, the next one, number four, talking about the affair in the wrong way. Okay, so a lot of times this blame shifting going on, people making statements of maybe I should never have left, you know, the affair partner, just very damaging things. And you have to understand, as they say, sticks and stones may break your bones, but words will never harm you. That is a lie. Sticks and stones can break your bones, but words can kill you. Words can do what sticks and stones cannot. And you have to be very careful what you say, how you say what you say, and your whole approach to this affair recovery process. Because in these emotional times, a lot of painful things are said, and it's hard to take those things back. And so think about it. That's why you need a third partner or third party to guide you through a process to make sure that you have reasonable conversations, because one of the things that's exposed in a marriage is the inability to effectively communicate. You know, couples struggle with communication as is, but then add an affair to the mix, it just becomes that much more complicated, and you're so soaked, saturated, and drenched in emotions, and it does not go well. So please get help as soon as you possibly can. Let's go to the next one. Number five, blaming yourself. We see this all the time. We see where affair partner said, well, you know, I'm sorry, the spouse of the affair partner says, you know what, maybe if I cooked better, maybe if I was prettier, maybe if I had a different body, maybe if I gave my spouse more sex, maybe if I showed up in a better way. And they're taking on the blame and the responsibility for their spouse's actions. And here's the reality. Let's just be clear. There are certain marital patterns that exist that can certainly create a vulnerability for an affair to occur, for a divorce to occur. And so you may have contributed to that. And maybe there are some areas where you do need to improve, where you do need to get better. But that has nothing to do with the decision that your spouse made to cheat. That is a decision that they have to own 100%. And guess what? No matter what the situation was in the relationship, they got themselves to the point through their own thinking and rationalization where they felt like, you know what? This is what I want to do for me. Because now we know that having an affair is a selfish act. So people operate not from a team of we perspective, but a team of me. What's going to make me happy? What's going to fulfill my needs? What's going to give me release? So they're no longer thinking about you in that moment. They're thinking about themselves. That's not your responsibility to own. That's not something that you should take the blame for. What you should take the blame for is your contribution to the relationship. And this is important because there's some people who are on the opposite end of the spectrum and take no responsibility for anything. Now, that's a problem as well. We've seen this where people say it's all his fault or it's all her fault or you know what? Fine. If there's any blame, it's 95-10. 95% his fault, 5% my fault. Well, what's the 5% that's your fault? Well, I don't really know, but I'm sure it's something. Like, that's a problem as well. So there's got to be some balance. So we can't put all the blame on the affair partner. We certainly can't take on all the blame ourselves. We have to put the blame for the decision on the spouse, but both of you have contributed in some way, in somehow, to the relationship. And so we say this all the time. When an affair happens, it's a result of two things. Either A, something that's going on inside of the relationship, the relational dynamic, or B, something going on inside of the person, or a combination of the two. And the reason why we have to say inside of the person, because truth be told, happy people cheat. There's some people who are in great relationships where things are going well. Great communication, great sexual fulfillment, great emotional connection. Everything is there. The spouse is showing up, dotting every I, crossing every T, just being fabulous in who he or she is. And still something within that spouse causes them to venture out. So that does happen. So we've got to be honest about that. But we also have to take accountability for what has happened. Now, in your conversations, if the spouse who cheated is why did you cheat? And if everything is reverted back to, well, when you did or what you didn't do or how you didn't show up, well, then he's not taking or she's not taking responsibility for their decision. So this is why this is a very touchy topic and something to really be discussed in order for people to handle this conversation well. All right. We got a lot of comments. Let me put these glasses back on so that I can read what it is that you wonderful people are saying. All right. So how do I discuss triggers without triggering your partner if we are both the offender? Well, the thing is this. If you both are the offender, you both have a sensitivity to what each other is going through. And so you can talk about triggers in a respectful way without rehashing the trigger. Understand that the thought of the affair, any reminder of an affair, is not necessarily the trigger. The trigger is the emotional reaction to the thought. So some people make it synonymous and it is not. So if I'm driving down the street and I see a sign and that sign reminds me of such and such, or if I'm listening to the song and the song reminds me of such and such, I'm triggered. No, that's not the trigger. The emotional reaction to the thought produces the trigger. And I think we have to be careful about what we're identifying as triggers, because we can misinterpret, you know, what it is that we're experiencing. And because there's a thought, it doesn't mean that that thought has power over us. The reality is, throughout the course of your journey together, thoughts will come. But how you manage those thoughts are critically important. So going back to your question, it's important that you create a safe environment. That's critically important, where you can talk in a non-judgmental zone. This is not for the purpose of attack. This is not for the purpose of being mean and spiteful and saying things that are going to hurt, harm, and hinder, but will help. So how do we create a non-judgmental zone, a loving environment for us to deal with difficult conversations? You know, folks, you have to get comfortable with being uncomfortable when dealing with these type of issues. That is the only way that you can really deal with this. So there's something called a thought journal, where you're writing down all the triggers that you have, right? You want to write down all the triggers that you have and that your spouse has, and then you want to share them with each other. The reason why you want to share them is because so your spouse is aware of what's triggering you throughout the course of the day. That way they can be there to help you heal, to help you adjust accordingly when these triggers occur. See, as spouses, you are co-laborers in this thing called marriage. You are partners together. And so my responsibility as a spouse is to do whatever I can to help you heal if I see that you are hurting and you are down, and vice versa. And these type of conversations are totally necessary in order to find the healing that you really need and in order to move things forward. I see there's a lot of comments coming in. I'm going to get to those comments in just a second. But what we want to do really quickly is go to a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back. This is an extended day. We're going to go past 26 minutes. Stay right there. We're going to come back to answer those questions. guys, we're back. Listen, if this is you and you know that you need help, reach out to us. We do intensives, we do individual sessions, we do couple sessions. Whatever you may need to get through your situation, that's why we're here. And that's why we show up every single morning to talk with you about some important information that'll make a pivotal difference in your life. All right, we got a number of comments. It's true that your husband or wife is the main responsible for the affair. What about when the person knows you and she is completely aware of what she is doing in your face? And even after the affair finished, you have to see the person at work. How to deal with that? Guys, I think I understand that. That's a little bit choppy. After the affair finished, you have to see that person at work. How do you deal with that? Okay, I think I understand what you're trying to say. So you've had an affair with somebody you work with, and the affair is over, but you still have to see them at work. Listen, this is a very sensitive issue for a spouse because now work becomes the trigger, okay? So in this situation, we've seen a number of different things happen. Number one, some people will leave that job because going there can create such an environment that you have not overcome that affair yet, and there's a vulnerability to reconnect, to re-engage, to still be secret and stealth in your contacts and interactions. And so for the sake of yourself and for the sake of your spouse not being triggered, some people have left their jobs and found others. You know, others have switched shifts. So maybe it's not realistic for you to lose or to leave your job, but switching shifts. So if they work in the day, I work at night, or if we move to different departments, or we move to different buildings, or we see if maybe there is another plant, another location, another site that I can put in for to relocate, to be out of the physical presence. But if none of that is the case and you have to be there with them every single day, the question is, are they a part of your normal working day-to-day responsibilities? Okay, if not, and it's only a social connection, then you've got to be integral and you've got to have accountability and you've got to be completely transparent with your spouse about what you're doing at work. You have to bring your spouse's presence with you to work. She's not physically there, but her presence is there, okay? So that's a deterrent. And also, you need to make your spouse completely aware for a period of time of what's happening at work. Being open and available and having access through text and through phone and through Marco Polo and FaceTime. This is what you have to do initially in the restoration process, because trust building is huge, all right? And so if that location is a trigger, then you've got to do whatever you can do to make your partner feel safe. And so one of the things that we do, we can't get into the details of that, but there's messaging that has to be clearly given to that affair partner who is still at your job, who you work with. And it's got to be crystal clear that it is over. And then there's a system of accountability that we create for the couple to ensure that lines are not crossed. If you're dealing with them day to day in terms of work functionality within that job, then once again, there's specific rules and parameters that need to be established that he or she needs to be aware of, that your spouse is aware of, to keep yourself in an integral space. We've seen even in certain circumstances how a supervisor or the boss, whoever the manager is, they are kind of aware of certain things that have happened. It's set in a safe environment and they're working with you to make sure that violations do not occur again. So there's a number of things that you can do to turn this thing around. All right, another question. Are you saying that an affair partner doesn't have a moral obligation in the matter, especially if they knew of the other spouse? Not excusing the marriage partner at all, but blame should be shared. I think let me reiterate what I said, if I understand your question. Everybody has a responsibility to the dynamics of the relationship, right? So if I said, I want you to evaluate your marriage on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being horrible, 10 being phenomenal, what rating would you give it? Okay, so you gave it a 5, okay. It's a 50%, you know. A 50% on a test would be like an F, right? So that's not a good score. And so am I saying that the affair partner should take no, am I saying that the betrayed spouse should take no responsibility for where the relationship is? Absolutely not. That's my whole point. There are things that both of you have done to contribute to potentially the state of the relationship. What I'm saying is that whoever had the affair, it is a decision that they made. A gun wasn't put to their head. It was a decision that they made. That's why we talk about what happens in the mind of the affair partner that brings them to that point where they will be willing to do that. So if you're now blaming your spouse, like for instance, I mean, we can go down several different examples. You know, I wanted more sex, and so therefore I wasn't getting it in the marriage, so I decided that I was going to watch porn. That's my decision. I decided that I was going to cheat and have sex with another person because I couldn't get sex in my marriage. That's your decision. Well, was that the best decision? Absolutely not. Should that have been the first of all, it shouldn't have been the first or the last, but for that to be your first decision, like what have you done in between that? Have you gone to counseling? Have you read a book? Have you had conversations? Have you looked into things? You know, have you gotten to the core of the issue as to why certain things weren't happening in that relationship or why your spouse wasn't showing up in a certain way? When you have effective communication and can deal with the root issue, you're able to get more resolution because you're getting breakthrough in those conversations. So you as the affair partner are 100% responsible for that affair, but both of you are responsible for the dynamics in the relationship. Young God. My wife says I blame her for my current affair, but she's cheating several times in the past, and I'm just finding out. Doing to my current affair, how should I handle that? Well, you should be out of your affair if you're in one. She should be out of an affair if she's in one. So, yes, okay, you cheated. That hurt me. I haven't been able to heal. And as a result, I have now cheated. And it's a result of what you've done. It's still 100% your responsibility to make that decision. And so I need to be clear. I need to be crystal clear. You cannot blame your spouse for your affair. You can have a shared blame and responsibility for the relationship that created a vulnerability for then you to make a decision to have an affair. I hope that's crystal clear and you're getting that, because we need to leave here with the right understanding so that we don't negatively or falsely point the finger at someone who's not due that level of responsibility for your actions. And this is why we say when an affair comes out and you're getting the help that you need, it is very possible for people to have better relationships after the affair than what they had before, because now the affair shines a light on everything that wasn't working well in the first place. And then when you go through a process of rebuilding, of restoring, of creating a healthy foundation to move forward, it works, right? And that really goes to the last point here. Point number six, one of the challenges for having a healthy conversation, people oftentimes don't get the help that they need after an affair. Listen, if you found out that you had a terminal illness, for you not to go to a doctor to get treatment would be insane. I'm gonna just tough this thing out. Eventually, it'll go away. I'm gonna take some medicine and I'm gonna get some rest. And no, Joker, you gonna die. Likewise, your marriage can die if it experiences a terminal illness that you do not treat. And many of us are in relationships that really is on life support, okay? Many of our relationships are like on hospice and we're still trying to figure it out and do it on our own and are not open to advice, not open to getting help. And it's just insane. You need to get help from somebody who can assist you in that process. All right, let's see what this says, Lawrence. And your spouse's affair partner also was a friend of yours. Your family and their family were also interacting on many occasions. Kids are play partners, etc. How do you manage going forward? That's a very good question, because this speaks to one of the complexities. See, it's very different if I'm having an affair with a stranger, with a coworker who's not a part of our community. But now when you have an affair with a family member, when you have an affair with a close member of a community, it impacts everything. So not only is there a breach of the marital relationship, there's a breach of those other social relationships. And so, truth be told, this leads to the demise of social settings. This leads to the demise of community when these type of things occur. These are the natural consequences that happen when an affair occurs, because it would be very difficult to know that I cheated with the neighbor and yet we're still getting together for barbecues and birthday parties and holidays. Those relationships are over. It's unfortunate that these are the consequences, but they are. Now, maybe there's a point, and let me just say this. This is why there's a major difference between forgiveness and reconciliation. See, because in your healing process, should you decide to stay with your spouse, yes, forgiveness is a part of reconciliation, forgiving your spouse for what was done, possibly forgiving that family member or that friend. But it does not mean that you have to reconcile with those other individuals. And if you do, okay, then there needs to be boundaries and borders and parameters put in place to protect any type of violation from ever happening again. But it's really hard to go back to the way it was when that type of thing has occurred. So that's why we need to be careful about the decisions that we make. You know, when it comes to an affair, many people say, you know what, my emotions got the best of me, my feelings got the best of me. And this is why we say feelings and emotions are not logical. They do not make sense. And that's why you have to use your mind to consider the consequences of your actions before you even indulge. Is this worth losing everything for? Is this worth compromising the integrity of my relationship for? Is this worth going through hell once it comes out and having to go through a recovery process that is very painstaking? Is it worth it, you know, for just a momentary fix or a season of relief? Especially if you plan on reconciling with your spouse. Because overwhelmingly, when many people cheat, they're not cheating because they want to leave that relationship. They're cheating to stay. Now, I know that sounds kind of weird, but if they were cheating to leave, they would just leave. They wouldn't need to cheat. Many people cheat because they really want the best of both worlds. So there's certain benefits that I get from this marriage, but then there's other benefits that I get from my mistress. I'm in a partnership with my spouse, but I have companionship with my mistress. And so because I'm getting both these things, wow, I never want this to end. But when it does, and you realize that you may lose the foundation, you may lose the marriage and the family, then you're just like, what did I do? And so we don't want you to continue to make that mistake and go down that path. We need you to use your mind and your reasoning, and that's why you need a healthy sounding board, and that's why you need to be a part of a community of people who are integral, who have character, who are doing the right thing, that can help you in your journey to get you to a place that you need to be. These are the things that we're talking about, guys. I hope that this was somewhat helpful. I know we were talking, we went a little bit over, but I wanted to get into these six areas that you need to consider when having these conversations. Listen, guys, the questions are coming in, but what we're going to do is we're going to extend this conversation because this seems to be a hot topic and it's what we need to be talking about. And so if you have a question, please reach out to us. You can reach out to us on our website at couplesacademy.org. You can set up a discovery call. It's a 15-minute call where you can get the answers to your questions so that we can help navigate you through the struggle that you're going through. We're almost approaching a new year. You do not want to go into a new year the way that your relationship currently is. Do something different. Give us a call. We're Couples Academy. This is the Couples Academy Show. Love you guys. See you on tomorrow.